الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم. We are still studying together the book of Sheikh Al-Allama Muhammad ibn Salih bin Uthaymeen rahimahullah, lessons on fasting, Taraweeh, Zakat, and 48 questions and answers on fasting. The Sheikh, after he spoke about the nullifiers of the fast, he said, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, a fasting person does not break his fast with any of the above, means what he had mentioned, unless he first meets three conditions. So what does this statement mean? What does the Sheikh mean by this statement? You want me to repeat again? The Sheikh, he said, a fasting person does not break his fast with any of the above unless he first meets three conditions. What does he mean by that? No, but what does he mean by this statement? He's talking about the fasting person.
If he meets these three criteria, then he breaks his fast. If it's not, then he does not break his fast.
No, it's the opposite. If he meets these three conditions, right? If he has these conditions, like for example, if he has ignorance, right? Does he break his fast or he doesn't break his fast? Does not break his fast. So in order for the ruling to be applicable, all the conditions have to be met and all the barriers have to be removed. Is that clear? In order for a ruling to be applicable, all the conditions have to be met and all the barriers have to be removed. For example, if someone committed a nullifier of the fast while this person was ignorant about the ruling, now, is his fast still valid or invalid? What do you say? Is his fast valid or invalid?
Valid.
Why? Why is it valid?
Because
of the ignorance, because there is a barrier. Because there is a barrier. And this barrier is ignorance. So the ruling will not be applicable on this person. Likewise, if someone covered his head, a male covered his head while he was in Hajj. So he put on like a kufi, for example, not knowing the ruling of that. Does he have to expiate? Does he have to do anything?
No.
Why? Because there is a barrier. What is this barrier?
Ignorance.
And this is very important for us to understand. Very important for us to understand. The Sheikh, he said, the first condition, he must be aware of its ruling. He must be aware of its ruling. In other words, if he was not aware of its ruling and he was ignorant, then that ruling will not be applicable to him, will not be applicable to that person. And the time for which it applies. Second, he must be conscious, i.e. one is not accountable for forgetfulness. So in other words, if he did something out of forgetfulness, then Allah will not hold him accountable. Allah will not hold the person accountable if he did something out of forgetfulness. Because Allah said in the Quran, Surah Al-Baqarah, رَبَّنَا لَا تُؤَاخِذْنَا إِن نَسِيْنَا أَوْ أَخْطَأْنَا. O our Lord, do not hold us accountable. If we forget or we err. So when you do things out of forgetfulness, Allah will not hold you accountable. Plus, the action is still valid. It's still valid. Like for example, someone forgot and he covered his head while he is in a state of ihram. So there is nothing upon this man. There's nothing upon him. Or he forgot, for example, and he drank water. Or he ate while he was fasting. And then he remembered, there's nothing upon him. And he gets to keep the day. And the day is valid. Because Allah will not hold someone accountable for forgetfulness. Likewise, when you do something by error, you do something by error, by accident, Allah will not hold you accountable. But when it comes to حقوق العباد, حقوق العباد, the rights of your fellow Muslims. For example, someone forgot and ate someone's lunch. Can happen. So he ate someone else's lunch. Does he have to pay back the damages or he doesn't have to? He has to pay back the damages. طيب. Likewise, if he did something by accident, he took someone's money, he thought it was his, and he spent it. And then he realized that was not his money. So he has to pay back the damages. طيب. Sheikh Sa'di rahimahullah, he said, وَالْخَطَأُ وَالنِّسْيَانُ وَالْإِكْرَاهُ أَسْقَطَهُ مَعْبُودُنَ الرَّحْمَانُ. We understand this foundation. Sheikh Sa'di rahimahullah, he said, وَالْخَطَأُ وَالنِّسْيَانُ وَالْإِكْرَاهُ. So he said, الْخَطَأُ is when you do things by accident. وَالنِّسْيَانُ and forgetfulness. وَالْإِكْرَاهُ is when you do something against your will. When you do something against your will. You do something under duress. What did he say? أَسْقَطَهُ مَعْبُودُنَ الرَّحْمَانُ. Our Lord, the Most Gracious, he drops the blame on that person and he does not hold him accountable. So Allah will not hold you accountable for that. These three. Barriers. They call them mawani' at-takleef. The barriers of a takleef. Takleef means someone is held accountable, like us, because we have reached puberty. So we are mukallafin. Mukallafin means we are held accountable for our deeds. We are held accountable for our sins. We are held accountable for what we do, good or bad. So he said, أَسْقَطَهُ مَعْبُودُنَ الرَّحْمَانِ. Our Lord, the Most Gracious, he does not hold that person accountable. He does not hold that person accountable. But he said in the other line, لَكِنْ مَعَ الْإِتْلَافِ. لَكِنْ مَعَ الْإِتْلَافِ. But with destroying someone's property, or using someone's money or something like that. What he said, لكن مع الإتلاف يثبت البدل. البدل means the alternative. The damage has to be paid off. That's what it means. So if he destroys someone's property while he was forgetful, or he was forced to do it against his will, or something like that, then he has to pay back the damages. Of course, the one who was forced him, if this person had no other choice, then the person who forced him, he's responsible for that. Now, لكن مع الإتلاف يثبت البدل وينتفي عنه التأتيم والزلل. As far as sinning and all, that would not be held against him. The Shaykh said, and the third, he must do it intentionally and willingly. Intentionally and willingly. So if a person has hijama done for him while not knowing that it breaks his fast is still valid since he is just unaware of his ruling. Is that clear? Right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَيْسَ عَلَيْكُمْ جُنَاحٌ فِيمَا أَخْطَأْتُمْ بِهِ وَلَكِنْ مَا تَعَمَّدَتْ قُلُوبُكُمْ. And there is no sin on you in those matters in which you err. In which you err. You do things by mistake. But rather only those which your heart deliberately intend. which your heart deliberately intend Surah Al-Ahzab. And he also says, رَبَّنَا لَا تُؤَخِذْنَا إِن نَسِينَا أَوْ أَخْطَأْنَا. Our Lord, do not punish us if we forget or err. Surah Al-Baqarah. The Shaykh said, it is reported that Allah said about this, I have already done so, means I have forgiven you. Also, it is reported in the two Sahih collection that Adi ibn Hatim, radiallahu anhu, he placed a white and a black thread under his pillow and then begin to eat and look at them because he misunderstood the ayah. Understand? He misunderstood the ayah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَكُولُوا وَشْرَبُوا حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ لَكُمُ الْخَيْطُ الْأَبْيَضُ مِنَ الْخَيْطِ الْأَسْوَدِ مِنَ الْفَجْرِ. And do not. And eat and drink until the white thread of dawn becomes distinct from the black thread of the night.
Because the night is dark.
Naam. So he misunderstood the ayah. So he thought it was a black thread, the physical black thread. You understand? طيب. So then he began to eat and look at them, because he didn't understand the meaning of that. So when one of them would become distinct from the other, he would refrain from eating, thinking that this is what was meant by Allah's statement. وَكُلُوا وَشْرَبُوا in Surah Al-Baqarah حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ لَكُمُ الْخَيْطُ الْأَبْيَضُ مِنَ الْخَيْطِ الْأَسْوَدِ مِنَ الْفَجْرِ ثُمَّ أَتِمُّ الصِّيَامَ إِلَّيْلِ. And eat and drink until the white thread, light of dawn, you know, the crack of dawn when it just starts, right, become distinct to you from the black thread, darkness of the night, then complete your fast until the nightfall. Surah Al-Baqarah. When the Prophet ﷺ was informed of this, he said, إِنَّمَا ذَلِكَ بَيَاضُ النَّهَارِ وَسَوَادُ اللَّيْلِ. Then the Prophet ﷺ, he told them, this only refers to the whiteness of the daylight and the blackness of the night. And he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, did not order him to repeat his fast. Why? Because he was not aware of that. He didn't know. If someone eats thinking that Fajr did not come yet, or that the sun has set, but then the opposite of what he thought becomes clear to him, his fast is still valid. Since he was unaware of the time. It is recorded in Sahih al-Bukhari that Asma bint Abi Bakr radiyallahu anha said, "Aftarna fi 'ahdi an-nabiy sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fi yawm ghaym thumma tala'at ash-shams." We broke our fast once during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on a foggy day. It was overcast. Okay? Then the sun appeared to us. They thought it was, that's it, Maghrib. You know? I.e. it had not set yet. So if making up that fast was obligatory, the Prophet ﷺ would have clarified it to us, since Allah perfected the religion through him. And had the Prophet ﷺ clarified it, the companions would have transmitted it, since Allah entrusted them with safeguarding the religion, right or wrong. Yeah. So the Prophet ﷺ, he approved of this. He did not command them to make it up. There is nothing from the companions that the Prophet ﷺ commanded them to make up the fast. You see? Tayyib, the Shaykh, he said, so based on the fact that the companions did not transmit it, we come to know that it is not obligatory. Also, there are many reasons that call for knowledge of it to be transmitted due to its importance. So it would not be possible for it to have been forgotten. Also, if one is forgetful while fasting, he does not break his fast. This is based on the Prophet's statement, مَن نَسِيَ وَهُوَ صَائِمْ فَأَكَلَ أَوْ شَرِبَ فَلْيُتِمَّ صَوْمَهُ فَإِنَّمَا أَطْعَمَهُ اللَّهُ وَسَقَاهُ. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whoever forgets while fasting and eats and drinks, then he must continue and complete his fast, for indeed it was only Allah who fed him and gave him to drink. Agreed upon. If someone is forced to eat, or if he rinses his mouth and some water escapes into his stomach, right? It can happen when someone is performing the wudu, right? It can happen, right? Or some drops of water go into his eyes, like rain. Sometimes the rain can be heavy. And escape into his body interior. Or has a wet dream. Has a wet dream. And some semen comes out. Then in all of these cases, a person's fast is still valid. Why? Why is that?
Out of his control.
Because it's out of his control. Something that you cannot control. The Shaykh, he said, rahimahullah ta'ala, all of these occurred without him doing them intentionally or willingly. A person does not break his fast by using the siwak. So you can actually use the siwak. You can use the siwak. Rather, it is sunnah for him as well as others to use it at any time, in the beginning or at the end of the day. Some of the fuqaha, Muslim jurists, they say you should not use it, you should use it only half of the day, but there is no proof and evidence that says you use it only half a day. So you can use it anytime you want. It is also permissible for fasting person to do that which will alleviate the severity of the heat and thirst from him, such as wiping himself with cold water and so on. So for example, taking a cold shower, it's okay. It's okay, inshallah. There's no problem. كان يصب الماء الماء على رأسه وهو صائم من العطش. The Prophet ﷺ would pour water over his head while fasting due to thirst. So he used to do that, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Ibn Umar, radiallahu anhu, would wet a garment and place it on himself while fasting. So you can also do it. Take a towel, wet it with cold water, and then put it on your head, you could do that. There's no problem, inshallah. This is from the ease that Allah intended for us. And to Allah belongs the praise and gratitude for the blessings and ease He grants. Alhamdulillah. See, there are always ways. You know, if you feel thirsty or something like that, you can take a shower, cold shower, put like a cold towel on your head, something like that. Sit by the air conditioner, you know. Alhamdulillah, there are different ways. Alhamdulillah, they're all permissible. Lesson 5. The Shaykh is going to go to Salat al-Taraweeh. Salat al-Taraweeh. The Shaykh, he said, Taraweeh refers to performing the night prayer in congregation during the month of Ramadan. The time that it may occur is from after Isha prayer until the commencement of Fajr. All that time is Salat al-Taraweeh. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam encouraged us to perform the night prayer during Ramadan. He says, "Man qama Ramadana imanan wa ihtisaban, ghufira lahu ma taqaddama min dhanbihi." Whoever performs the night prayer in Ramadan with faith and while seeking to be rewarded will have all his past sins forgiven. And in Sahih Bukhari, Aisha radiallahu anha reported that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam performed the night prayer one night in the masjid and led the people in prayer. Then he prayed the next night and the people increased. Then the people gathered on the third or the fourth night, but he did not, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, go out to them. The next morning he said, قَدْ رَأَيْتُ مَا صَنَعْتُمْ فَلَمْ يَمْنَعُنِي مِنَ الْخُرُوجِ إِلَيْكُمْ إِلَّا أَنِّي خَشِيتُ أَن تُفْرَضَ عَلَيْكُمْ. Allahu Akbar. So this is what he told the people in the morning. He told them, I saw what you people did last night. And nothing prevented me from going out to you, except that I feared that it would be made obligatory on you. You understand? That if the Prophet, he feared that he would to come out to them, Allah may reveal to him, right? To make Salat al-Tarawih obligatory, like Salat al-Isha, it would be hard. Huh? It would be hard. Right? A lot of people, they cannot tolerate that, especially sick and other than that. So the sunnah is to limit the night prayer to 11 raka'ah. This is the sunnah. Making the taslim after every 2 raka'ah. This is because when Aisha radiallahu anha was asked about the Prophet's prayer during Ramadan, she replied, ما كان يزيد في رمضان ولا في غيره على 11 ركعة. This is the mother of the believer, Aisha radiallahu anha, our mother, the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. She said he sallallahu alaihi wasallam would not exceed 11 rak'at in or out of Ramadan. So whether it is in Ramadan or outside Ramadan, he will not go beyond 11 rak'at. So this is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is his sunnah. And this is what we do here in this masjid. In Al-Muwatta, do you know who this book belongs to? Al-Muwatta. Anybody knows? Muwatta belongs to Al-Imam Malik. Malik ibn Anas. Al-Imam Malik ibn Anas. You have Al-Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah. And you have Al-Imam Malik ibn Anas. And then you have Al-Imam Shafi'i Muhammad ibn Idris. And you have Al-Imam Ahmad Al-Shaybani. These are the 4 imams. So the second one, Al-Imam Malik ibn Anas, he has a book called Al-Muwatta, where he collected the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he also collected the narration from the Sahaba and the Tabi'een, called Al-Muwatta. In Al-Muwatta, Muhammad ibn Yusuf, who is a reliable and trustworthy, reported from Sayyib ibn Yazid, who was a companion that Umar radiallahu anhu ordered Ubay ibn Ka'b and Tamim al-Dari to lead the people in prayer performing 11 raka'at. So he ordered them to, but Ubay ibn Ka'b, who was a companion, who was a very good reciter of the Quran, by the way. Ubay ibn Ka'b is well known for his knowledge of the Quran. And also Tamim al-Dari, radiallahu anhu. So if one chooses to exceed the number of 11 rak'ah, there is no harm. Sheikh, there is no harm. If someone wants to pray 20 rak'ah, for example, there is no problem. There is no harm. This because once when the Prophet ﷺ was asked about the night prayer, he replied, Matna, matna. Matna, matna. Matna, matna means 2 by 2. Means you can pray 2 rak'at and then you pray another 2 rak'at and you keep going. So he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was asked about the night prayer, he said, Matna, matna, fa'idha khashiya ahadukum al-subha, salla rak'atan wahidatan tutiru lahu, ma qad salla. He said, it is 2 by 2, means rak'at. Then if one fears that morning will befall him, the morning is getting close, he should pray 1 rak'ah, which will make what he prayed witr, odd. So if he prayed like 20 rak'ah, then you pray 1 rak'ah, that's going to be 21. So it's going to close all your prayer. Right? It's going to close all your prayer. Now, so al-witr is the odd number, and shafi' is the opposite. That's why it's called shafi' wal-witr. Some people, they say, shafi', I'm going to pray shafi' wal-witr, right? A shif' is what? Even number, which is 2 rak'at. And then you see a lot of people in the masjid, they do that. They pray 2, and then they pray another 1. Right? And you can pray 3 together. You can pray 3 together with 1 taslim. But you don't sit in the second rak'ah and you do tashahud. You don't do that. Because the Prophet ﷺ, he forbade us from likening witr to Maghrib. Okay? So it is not permissible to sit and do the tashahud in the second rak'ah of al-witr. So you pray the first rak'ah, you recite al-fatiha and surah al-a'la. سَبِّحْ اسْمَ رَبِّكَ الْأَعْلَى. And in the second rak'ah, you recite al-fatiha and قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ. And in the third rak'ah, you recite قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ. So if you want to join three of them together, you can do that. If you want to pray two, you salam out, then you pray another one, that's good. All of them is fine. The Shaykh, he said, Rahimahullah ta'ala, however, preserving and sticking to the number that is reported in the sunnah while performing it slowly and lengthening it is in a manner that does not burden the people is better than more and more complete. So the Shaykh is telling you that it is better to stick to the sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, which is how many? 11 rakat. 11 rakat. This is better. As long as you don't burden the people. You don't make it too long in a way that it becomes, you know, a burden on the people. Because the people, not all of them are healthy and young. Some of them, they're sick. And some of them, they have special need. And other than that, some of them, they have a business. Some of them, they have a job. And so on and so forth. The Sheikh said, as for what some people do, such as rushing through the prayer. You know, there is an imam, actually, they call him Imam Ferrari. Imam Ferrari. The way he prays is unbelievable. It's not permissible to pray like that. Because you're missing out the meaning of the prayer. Because the prayer is supposed to be tranquil, supposed to have tranquility in the prayer. You fulfill the conditions of the prayer, the pillars of the prayer, the obligatory acts, and the sunan, and your khushu' also, not just rushing. And so a lot of people do that, unfortunately. So the Shaykh said, as for some people, do such as rushing through the prayer in an exaggerated manner, then this is contrary to what has been prescribed in the religion. If praying in this manner causes him to leave out one of the requirements of the four pillars of the prayer, he has invalidated his prayer. You see? So for example, if he's rushing, and then he missed one of the pillars, he doesn't have tranquility, right, in his prayer. His prayer is invalid. The Shaykh, he said, many of the imams that lead the congregation today do not take their time with the Taraweeh prayer. And this is wrong. An imam is not just leading himself in prayer. Rather, he is leading himself and others. So he is like a leader. He is required to do what is most beneficial and appropriate. The scholars have mentioned that it is detested for the imam to rush through the prayer to the point that those following him in prayer cannot do the act they are obligated to do. Some imams are like that, subhanAllah. Some of them, they don't even give you a chance to finish your Fatiha. Subhanallah. Right or wrong? I don't know if you ever prayed behind somebody like that. Have you? Yeah, they're very fast. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. Where are you going? I mean, subhanAllah. They don't even give you a chance to finish reciting al-Fatiha and to make dua while you are in sujood. They don't give you that opportunity to make dua. As soon as you say, Subhana Rabbi al-A'la, that's it. He says, Allahu Akbar, subhanAllah. And this is incorrect. The Shaykh, he said, the people should persevere in establishing this Taraweeh prayer and not cause it to go to waste by going from masjid to masjid. For indeed, whoever performs the night prayer with the imam until he finishes, it is written for him that he prayed the entire night, even though he may go to sleep after the prayer is over. Subhanallah. Look at that. Look at the reward. So because some people, what they do, they go here to this imam, they pray behind him two rak'at. And then they go to another imam, they pray. This is wrong, incorrect. Yeah, some people like that. Some people, they follow beautiful recitation. He say, you know what? Let's go to this imam here. His recitation is better than this imam. Let's go. And even though the other imam is like next door, so they have to travel, some of them, an hour to go to another imam. Ah, yes. But the intent is not just the recitation. It's the khushu' in the salat. And listening to the Qur'an and benefiting from the recitation of the Qur'an and reflecting upon the Qur'an. Yes. And they go here, they pray two rak'at here, and then they go to another masjid, they pray two rak'at. And then another masjid, they pray two rak'at. Four rak'at here, four rak'at here. This is incorrect. Because now they're missing out the reward of the hadith of Prophet ﷺ. Whoever stays with the imam until the imam finishes the salat, the taraweeh, he will get the reward of a night's prayer. The whole night. Now, the Shaykh said, there is no harm in women attending the taraweeh prayer if they do not fear fitna. If they don't like, for example, wear perfume. Some of the women, they wear perfume to come to the masjid. It's haram. It's not permissible for them to wear perfume or makeup, beautify themselves. Some of them, subhanAllah. Especially on Eid, when they come to the masjid, it's like they're coming to a beauty contest. لا حول ولا قوة إلا. And those men who are married to them, they don't move a finger, nothing, they don't care. This is incorrect. The women, they're supposed, when they come, there's no problem, they can come. But they have to abide by the rules of the Sharia. They have to be properly covered. And also, no perfume. Right? And so on and so on. No mixing with the man and the like. Some people, because of culture, they mix culture with Islam. So you find the man going to the woman's side trying to talk to his wife, and other, there are other sisters there. This is incorrect. Incorrect. You knock at the door, you stand behind the veil, the curtain, and you call for your wife to come out, and then that's it. You talk to her. But don't go inside where the women are. This is aib. This is not right. So the Shaykh, he said, on condition that they come out of their homes covered properly and not indecently exposing their adornment or while perfumed. See? So they have to be abide by the Sharia, because the Sahabiyat, the women companion, they used to come to the masjid of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but they used to be well covered. Some women, subhanallah, Allah may Allah guide them, they're very cultural. And they wear, as one brother called it, not hijab, sijab. Sijab, not hijab. So it's showing her hair and everything. This is not proper. This is not proper. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us all beneficial knowledge and righteous action. والحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم. The brother, he asked about zakat. And the brothers, and remember, who asked about the zakat. Is zakat going to be included here? Yes, zakat is going to be included here. The Sheikh is going to talk about it on the next class. Lesson 6 is going to talk about zakat. This is going to be, inshallah, Friday night, between Maghrib and Isha, we're going to cover this lesson about zakat and its benefit. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reward Al-Sheikh Al-Allama Muhammad bin Salih Al-Uthaymeen, Al-Firdaus Al-A'la. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all Al-Firdaus Al-A'la. May Allah forgive our sins. May Allah increase us in beneficial knowledge and righteous action. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. وصلى الله وسلم على محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم. تفضل.
So, for instance, there is an overcast.
نعم.
And they believe that the sun has gone down, and it's time for them to break the fast. However, and the overcasts diminishes and they still see the sun, it's still permissible for them to eat the food.
If they thought it was sunset.
No.
Yes. So they broke their fast. No. Then after that, the sun came up. They don't have to make up the day. As it happened in the lifetime of the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as it is in the hadith of Asma, the daughter of Abu Bakr Siddiq, radiallahu anhu.
So it wasn't permissible, for instance, they had three khujurs.
No.
But there's still sun.
Yes.
It's not for them to say, okay, I'm going to wait until sun comes, then I can proceed to eat. They can go ahead and continue to eat if they want.
Right? Yeah, that's it. Yes, now. That's it?
Last year I was a masjid, right? I was traveling to break my fast. I see that the sun is set, so I break my fast.
Okay.
But the azan didn't go off. So
even if the adhan did not go off, as long as the sun sets, as long as you know it is Maghrib time, then there is no problem, inshallah. Because that's what matters. When the sun sets, the adhan may come after. Some of the adhan, you know, because they go by calculation, you know. So, and this calculation, they're not 100% correct. And they're not 100% accurate. They give you an idea. Sometimes, the people call the adhan before the sunset. It happens a lot. Many masajid do that. Because they are like a robot. They go by the... You understand? They go by that. They don't go by the physical evidence, because to go by priorities when it comes to this affair, the scholars, they say the physical evidence should go first. Then you can go by this. So because this gives you an idea, this timetable, Salatal timetable, gives you an idea. But what you did is right. Yes. And sometimes you may hear the adhan and you look at the sun and say, wait a minute, this is not the time. You know? And it happens to one of the brothers. He said that one time he went to this masjid to pray Salat al-Maghrib. And he saw the people coming out. He said, wait a minute. You already prayed? The sun has not set yet. Yeah, but why? Because they go by the calculation. Yes, now.
They do, I don't know if they do it anymore, but when I was younger, they would do two adhans for Maghrib.
Two adhans?
So one for break the fast, another one for the salat al-Maghrib.
This is very ajeeb. This is bid'ah, actually. This is innovation, because the Prophet ﷺ, he never did that. He did not command Bilal radiallahu anhu to call the adhan, then Abdullah ibn Umi Maktoum to call another adhan. There's nothing like that. The only case that we know is Jumu'ah. The adhan of Jumu'ah that was initiated by Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu. But that had a reason to be initiated. Because at the time of his caliphate, Islam spread far and wide. And so there was a need for the second adhan, because there were so many Muslims, so many people in the marketplaces. So they would call the first adhan so that the people would get ready for the salat. So if they are doing a business transaction, they stop everything, they go home, they make ghusl, they dress well, then they come to the masjid, and then the second adhan for al-khatib to stand on the minbar and deliver the khutbah. That was the practice of Uthman radiallahu anhu. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, عَلَيْكُمْ بِسُنَّتِي وَسُنَّةِ الْخُلَفَاء الرَّاشِدِينَ الْمَهْدِيِّينَ مِنْ بَعْدِي. He said, stick to my sunnah and the sunnah of the rightly guided caliph that will come after me. So what Uthman did is from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Now, for instance, when the adhan has been called, you can make two rakat and your salat will be accepted.
Nah.
So, however, so in Salat al-Jama'ah, the adhan is called and the muadhin would rise and perform the lecture. So
the khatib, you mean?
Yeah, no. the people who rise up to give the lecture, but they still want to pray the
Tahiyyat Masjid.
Yeah.
If someone comes in.
No, like they were here from the beginning.
No, at that time you don't.
No, right?
You don't at that time. When you come in into the masjid, you pray two rak'at tahiyyat al-masjid. But when the khatib starts, you don't. Unless you have entered. If you have entered the masjid and you have not prayed two rak'at tahiyyat al-masjid, according to the most correct opinion, because there is difference of opinion among the scholars on this, but the most correct opinion, you make two rak'at, but you don't elongate them. You make them as brief as possible. Why? Because the Prophet ﷺ was delivering a khutbah, and one of the companions came in, and he sat down. He said, did you pray two rak'at? He said, no, Messenger of Allah. He said, get up and pray two rak'at, and make them brief. You understand? So based on that, you can pray tahiyyat al-masjid if you walked in while the khatib is delivering the khutbah. Right? But if you were already in the masjid sitting and then the adhan was called, you don't get up and start praying. No. This is not known from the Prophet ﷺ or his companions. They used to do this. Because there is no sunnah before Jum'ah. There is sunnah after Jum'ah. After Jum'ah. You can pray, if you go home, you pray two. In your home, you pray two rak'at. If you pray it like in the masjid, you pray four. For example, you're not going to go home, you're going to go back to work. Right? So you can either pray in the masjid four rak'at, or you pray in the office four rak'at. But if you go to your home, you pray two rak'at. But before that, there is no sunnah before Jum'ah. Sunnah before Dhuhr, yes. Sunnah before Dhuhr. Prophet ﷺ said, whoever prays four rak'at before Dhuhr and four rak'at after Dhuhr, Allah will prevent his body from entering the fire. Yes. If you pray four rak'at before Dhuhr and four rak'at after Dhuhr. But Jumu'ah is an independent prayer. Independent prayer. And it is not known. The Prophet ﷺ used to make sunnah before Jumu'ah. It's not known. So whoever does this, he's going against the sunnah. Yes, after, not before. Now.
After it will be like four rak'at?
Four rak'at if you pray, for example, other than your home. Oh. But if you pray in your home, you pray two rak'at only. Yes. Yes. That's it. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us all beneficial knowledge and righteous action. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala Muhammadin wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam.